立法會主席.
President. Members will please remain standing while the Chief Executive enters the chamber. Chief Executive. Members who are entering the chamber will please keep quiet. Keep quiet, please. Mr. Leung Kwok-hong, keep quiet. Members, keep quiet, please. If members do not observe the rules of procedure, we'll never be able to start. Mr. Leung Kwok-hong, Mr. Leung, please. Mr. Leung Kwok-hong, this is the last warning. If you do not keep quiet, I have to order you out of the chamber. Mr. Mei-fun-kwok, President, my view, my sideline is blocked. Mr. Gary Fan, will you please put down the suitcase? The Chief Executive will first address the Council. President, honorable members, fellow citizens, I am pleased to come here again since the policy address in January to speak at this Council and take questions from members. The most significant issue for the SARG and the LegCo in the months ahead must be the Chief Executive election in 2017 by universal suffrage. The Task Force on Constitutional Reform has just completed a second round of public consultation this month. The SAR government intends to publish the consultation report in April and put forth a resolution to amend Annex 1 of the Basic Law regarding election of the CE. We expect the Council will get the scrutiny and the voting out of the way prior to the summer recess. The SAR government's stance on constitutional reform cannot be clearer. We firmly believe that to implement universal suffrage for CE election, we must scrupulously act in accordance with the Basic Law and the NPCSC interpretations and decisions. And this is the constitutional framework we have to abide by. The general public ardently desire universal suffrage. They hope that in 2 years' time, they will be able to walk into a polling booth to select the next chief executive by one person, one vote, and not just watch 1,200 people to do so on television. To realize CE election by one person, one vote represents a historic step forward for Hong Kong's democracy. The state leaders repeatedly stressed to me that the central authorities truly and sincerely want Hong Kong to have universal suffrage for the CE election in 2017. Article 45 of the Basic Law clearly provides for this. The NPCSC sets out in 2007, a clear timetable for this to happen. On August 31st last year, the NPSC laid down the constitutional basis and framework for universal suffrage in 2017. So the central authority's position is sufficiently clear. And the steps are very clear, and that is to implement universal suffrage as scheduled in accordance with the law. Various recent opinion polls do show that the public want universal suffrage for CE election in 2017. Those who accept universal suffrage according to August 31st NPCSC decisions outnumber those who do not. This reflects what public aspirations are. They are being rational and pragmatic. In pursuit of democracy, they fully realize that a vote in hand is better than no vote, and to take a big step forward is better than to stand still. In the five-step process, we've already taken two steps, and the third one is just ahead of us. This step is the decision for Let's Go. The coming 3 months will be the most critical. Whether universal suffrage in 2017 will happen will be in the hands of two-thirds of the members here. The electorate will closely monitor how members will decide the voting rights of 5 billion Hong Kong people. At this historical juncture, the overall social and long-term interest outweighs personal and partisan interests. In terms of historical responsibilities, the voting rights of 5 million outweigh personal gains. I truly hope the members will have Hong Kong's democracy at heart and not deprive 5 million people of their rights to vote and let them down. In the months ahead, the SAR government will continue to seek member support to endorse the proposal for universal suffrage in 2017. Other than constitutional reform, the SAR government is no less concerned about livelihood. Therefore, the policy address in the budget have rolled out measures that benefit the public. However, last year, when considering the appropriation bill, some members spent a pretty long time filibustering. And though the bill was passed, we have wasted a considerable amount of time. At the Finance Committee, the funding proposal for the Northeast NT was again filibustered. Not only was the proposal delayed, many livelihood measures on the agenda were also seriously delayed, like the low-income family allowance, extra CSSA payment, rent waiver for the PRH tenants, much to the detriment of the members of the public. And this is what happened last year. This year, Let's Go is again beset by serious filibustering. As of February, FC has convened 38 sessions of meetings, or a total of 76 hours, up by three times on the same period last year. However, the number of projects dealt with is the smallest in years, only 15, 11 of them from the backlog of last year. The same can be said about the PWSC. The funding proposal for the IT Bureau also fell victim to filibustering. Let's Go is now scrutinizing the Appropriation Bill 2015. Later on, the Finance Committee will be discussing the budget initiatives, such as the extra payments for CSSA, rent waiver for PRH tenants, etc. The PwC and FC will consider the refurbishment of the Buddhist Hospital, the East Kowloon Cultural Center, and the multi-purpose sports complex at Kai Tak. All these are directly related to daily lives. In the interest of the members of the public, I hope that these members will cease filibustering forthwith. Over the past couple of months, the multiple entry permit remains a public concern. Under this policy, with the number of mainland visitors being on the rise, definitely people's lives have been disrupted by parallel trading activities. But there is a small number of people taking radical action to harass tourists and even local people. The increasing number of visitors are causing problems to some citizens, and the parallel trade activities are taking up public space, causing nuisance to local residents. The SAR government is taking this very seriously and maintaining close contact with the central and local authorities to jointly identify solutions. We have to tread carefully when dealing with visitor numbers. First, we have to minimize the impact on citizens' lives. Second, tourism is a source of employment for many grassroots people. Any measures contemplated have to have regard to the implications on the trade and the practitioners. Third, the multiple entry permit scheme involves many central and local administrations and the outbound movements of mainland residents. Any change to be made has to be carefully thought through. Complicated though it is, the SAR government will keep up the efforts. In the near term, though, the administration will continue to vigorously tackle parallel trading and arrest those suspected of engaging in these activities in breach of their condition of stay. Last year, March 14 to February 15, The immigration and the police mounted a total of 93 joint operations and arrested 831 mainland people for these activities, of whom 39 have been sentenced to jail for 8 weeks to 3 months. The immigration has put together a watch list of suspected parallel traders. As of February 2015, well over 13,500 mainlanders suspected of engaging in such activities have been put on the list. And over 28,500 have been refused entry. Besides, we will endeavor to maintain order on the streets and at boundaries, inspecting and prosecuting buildings involved in parallel trading, combating parallel traders, soft fund extension, and illegal parking and obstruction caused by parallel trading with a view to minimizing disruption to the public. The SAR government is only too aware of the impact caused by the sheer number of visitors. However, we can never tolerate acts over the past couple of weeks of storming shops and harassing visitors and local people. Not only are these acts in violation of the law, they seriously tarnish Hong Kong's international image. I find these acts wholly reprehensible, and the police will take vigorous enforcement action. I must reiterate that while tackling parallel trading, Hong Kong still welcomes mainland and overseas visitors with open arms, and I hope that every one of them will find Hong Kong a hospitable place. Thank you, President. I'll take questions from the floor. The Chief Executive will now answer questions. Mr. Chen Han Pan. Mr. Chief Executive, you've been putting a lot of efforts in the way of housing. An achievement is playing for everybody to see. Will you be the first one to become the first chief executive elected by one person, one vote? A chief executive must be able to defuse the bombs. Now we have the bomb in front of us, and that is what the policy address says get rid of the subdivided flats in industrial buildings, and there will be thousands of residents there who will have to find alternative homes. The government is doing the same in Tsuen Wan Wing Fung Industrial Building. There, the closure order has been issued. We have about 20 households living there. They are steadfastly refusing to leave, because if they are cleared, they will have to move into reception centers, and they will have to live in bunk beds. And a lot of them are women, and they can only go into the reception centers. Now, Chief Executive, can you bear to see these women being put in these places? The previous year, when we cleared these water huts or rooftop structures, we would first rehouse them before clearance. And will you do the same in this exercise? Now, we do have some interim housing that can be used as temporary housing for these people affected by the clearance. Chief Executive, thank you very much, Mr. Chen, for the question. The Legal Secretary, I think it was last week, wrote to the Secretary for Transport and Housing, Director of Housing, and I understand that the government has responded to the letter. I'm sure that this is dear to members' heart. Over the past years, housing has been in short supply in Hong Kong, boosting the property prices and making the supply very tight. And some people, in absence of an alternative, have moved into these illegal subdivided flats in industrial buildings. And not only are the living conditions undesirable, they are actually industrial buildings. In the vicinity, upstairs and downstairs, there are industrial activities going on. There are certain elements of fire risks and hazards. So the SAR government has no alternative but to do something about these units in accordance with the law. As regards rehousing, we will, in accordance with the established policy, deal with the issue. Now, when it comes to rehousing, now Mr. Chen Han Pan talked about the housing units that for rehousing. Now, we have a large number of people. We can only, according to the existing policy, provide them with temporary housing. And we'll see whether they are going to be rendered homeless. And depending on the situation, we will offer them assistance. There is also an element of fairness here.
For those families living in SDUs, in factory buildings, because of safety and other concerns, we have to require them to move out and then give them rehousing units. But if we give them rehousing units that are favored by most people, then more people will move into SDUs. So it won't be helpful to address a housing problem. Mr. Chen Hanpan, Mr. Chief Executive, be it rooftop structures or squatter huts, we use the policy of rehousing first before clearance. So for SDUs, can you also introduce the same system, that is, rehousing before clearance, such that the sitting tenants won't put up a very strong opposition and those people who are living in factory buildings don't have to live there anymore? Chief Executive, if we want to change any policy, we first of all have to know whether or not we can implement the policy. That is, whether or not, in accordance with the policy, we can satisfy those living in SDUs in factory buildings, be they families or individuals. Can we address their housing needs? Overall speaking, what are the circumstances surrounding the SDUs in factory buildings? The government has been conducting studies on that. Well, we'll formulate policies, but we don't want to formulate policies that do not avail us of sufficient housing units for those now living in SDUs. Dr. Helena Wong, Mr. 689, yesterday you appealed to the electors to kick out the pan-democrats from the Legislative Council. What will be the result of a democratic election? Will respect the choice of the electors. Now, you're the chief executive. You're not yet half into your tenure of office. You have already divided society. 200 people took to the streets to protest and occupy sites. Executive legislature relationship had deteriorated, and your popularity rate has dropped to a record low. You just like an insult. Hong Kong people would like you to step down as early as possible. Now we cannot use our votes to drive you away. So Mr. 689, have you represent Hong Kong people in raising to the CPG the aspirations of Hong Kong people in relation to universal suffrage, to ask for a withdrawal of the NPCSC decision on August 31st and restart the constitutional reform process? If you haven't done so, will you strive for a genuine nomination system in this election so that Hong Kong people can really put up a real fight with you so that we can use our votes to kick you out? Mr. Lam Kwok Hong? Mr. President, Dr. Helena Wong knows very well that the chief executive is a big liar, and she is still asking that question. Was she wasting time? Well, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, I've already warned you. You sat in your seat and continuously made noises. You're wasting our time. If you continue to breach the rules of procedure, I'll order you to leave this chamber. So please be seated immediately. Chief Executive, Mr. Wong Kwok Kin, Mr. President, just now Dr. Helen Wong was asking Mr. 689, should the Chief Executive answer her questions? President, you should make a ruling. When councillors ask questions, they should direct their questions to the President. Previously, I reminded members that in the Legislative Council, members should not use offensive language against the Chief Executive. So I ask the Chief Executive to answer Dr. Helena Wong's questions. Mr. Chief Executive, Mr. President, I'd like to thank Dr. Helena Wong for her questions. Be it the trio on constitutional reform led by the Chief Secretary for Administration to collect public opinion, or the written report from the SARG, or what I raised with the state leaders when I met with them in Beijing, what I told them verbally, we truthfully reflected to them all sorts of views, whether or not they're in accordance with the basic law. So all sorts of views in relation to the 2017 CA election are very clear. This is point number one. Point number two, Dr. Helena Wong mentioned genuine universal suffrage. All of us are striving for that. Every society has its different electoral systems, electoral laws, rules of procedures, etc. Every society has its genuine universal suffrage. All elections in all societies are genuine universal suffrage, so long as the elections are based on their system, their constitution, and their electoral laws. Members, please keep silent. Chief Executive, in Hong Kong, we follow the basic law and the NPCSC decision in implementing universal suffrage. Mr. President, the CE has made it clear on this point. He said that all societies have genuine universal suffrage, but what about those in Myanmar, in North Korea? Are they genuine universal suffrage? So long as it is universal suffrage implemented in that jurisdiction, is genuine universal suffrage. In Hong Kong, we have a broadly representative nominating committee nominating candidates for the CA election. So this is genuine universal suffrage. Mr. Kwok-wai-keung, Mr. President, we have been discussing standard working hours for years, but now we don't hear any factors about standard working hours. Employers can put in long working hours in employment contract to evade overtime payment. So this is to guarantee that all employers will be scrupulous employers. If the government is trying to make use of the Committee on Standard Working Hours to do that, the labor sector will not accept it. Chief Executive, you have 2 more years in your tenure. How can you make sure that this committee will start to legislate on standard working hours and to work out the scope of the piece of legislation? Also, you said that you would not exclude the possibility of running for another term. So how will you deal with your manifesto? Chief Executive, in my manifesto, I promised you something, and I would implement all those promises one by one. The SARG attaches great importance to employees, particularly the grassroots employees, and their interests and benefits. After I assumed office, I implemented policies in relation to labor interests, including what I raised in my manifesto, that is paternity leave for men. That's implemented this month. And very soon, on the 1st of May, we'll have another round of discussion on the statutory minimum wage. Now, all these indicate that we're concerned about employees, particularly grassroots employees, and their interests. Standard working hours are complicated. There are different job types, different employers, and different employees. So how should we set standard working hours? We should listen to the views of all sectors of society. We have representatives from the employers, employees, scholars, experts, etc. We'll listen to their advice. We don't want to see one phenomenon, that is to formulate policies to protect labor interests and related policies, but when it comes to implementation, the result is counterproductive, such that labor interests are affected. A few days ago, I met with representatives from some European enterprises. I discussed with them. They had different experience. Some of them were more positive, some more negative. So keep an open mind in this. And finally, when it comes to implementation, we hope that we can take care of the aspirations of all sectors of the community, particularly to take care of labor interests. Mr. Kwok-wai-keung, Mr. Chairman, the Standard Working Hours Committee had been working for 2 years. We've been listening to them for 2 years. The chief executive said that he would launch policies whenever they're mature. So why should he not adopt such an approach? It seems that he's adopting a delaying tactic. No, we're not delaying this. Our job market, our labor market, comprises a number of elements which are closely related. Now, we don't want to have a domino effect, thus producing counterproductive effects. Mr. Gary Fan, you're not even like your predecessor, Mr. Donald Zhang, because you dare not have an open debate with the pandemocrats. Well, Mr. Leung Chun-ying claimed that he was the father of the individual visit scheme. Well, this is the Asia Week in 2011. You said then that in 2003 you represented the Tung Chi-hwa government to go to Beijing to discuss the IVS. You said that you rushed to the state leader's home. And the first remark from the state leader is that, Leung Chun-ying, you should think about this very carefully. It's not true that the CPG doesn't want to support Hong Kong. But once this door is closed, it's open, we're afraid that we'll be opening a floodgate. And C.Y. Leung, at that time you said that if the CPG supports IVS, Hong Kong will do all preparation work well. I'm confident. So C.Y. Leung, were you at that time overconfident in yourself? Now the IVS has developed to such a stage that it has totally deviated from the original policy intent. It's just like the housing policy of Tung Chi-hwa to build 85,000 housing units per year. There's so much resentment within members of the public now. Will you adjust your policy? You want to sacrifice the interest of Hong Kong people and make use of IVS to integrate Hong Kong with another city on the mainland. Are you going to blindly implement this mainland Hong Kong integration? Chief Executive, tourism is an important industry of Hong Kong. Its contribution to GDP is the same as that of other industries. So we must not neglect the contribution of tourism to Hong Kong. In particular, a huge number of grassroots are working in the tourism industry and have contributed to our economy. Without the IVS, many of our employees may become unemployed or underemployed. I don't want to see or hear in Hong Kong those of influence in the political circle a dwarfed description of the IVS. In the past few years, I always said that we should consider Hong Kong's capacity to cope, including the capacity of tourist attractions to cope, street capacity, and all sorts of services. The SARG will strike a good balance. And just now, the Honourable Member mentioned the handling of the mainland Hong Kong relationship. In the past 2-odd years, from the policies of the SARG, you can see that when Hong Kong's resources are limited and people from outside Hong Kong, mostly from the mainland, may need more resources, thus affecting Hong Kong people. So we'll give priority to Hong Kong people. It's just like mainland women giving birth to babies in Hong Kong. I announced that our GNO services could not cope, so we adopted that policy. For baby formula, we set this restriction order of 2 cans maximum. And for properties, we have to address the need of mainlanders to purchase properties in Hong Kong. So we have to take care of the needs of Hong Kong people. So you see, we understand that there are criticisms about these SARJ policies, but we have to maintain this policy of giving priority to Hong Kong people. So Mr. Gary Fan, rest assured that we'll balance demand and supply.
Mr. Fan, when CY Leung did not address my question, talked about the integration between Hong Kong and Shenzhen. Now, in this publication, you were asked why in 2003 you didn't ask C.H. Tong first, and then you presented a fait accompli to Hong Kong. Can you bear the responsibility over the IVS scheme and all the smuggling and parallel trading activities arising from that? In our debate, even the pro-establishment members cannot evade this issue. Will you be bearing the responsibilities? Now, when you knew about the situation at that time, we talked about using tourism, developing tourism to stimulate the economy, which was in the doldrums. Now the visitors have increased in number, and the parallel traders are causing disruption to orders. And we have to deal with the issues there. On two occasions, Mr. Gary Fan talked about integration between the two cities. I don't see any relevance of this with dealing with parallel trading activities. Now, there is some greater and greater interaction between Hong Kong and the mainland. We simply cannot or should not look at the number of mainland visitors coming to Hong Kong. We also have to look at the number of Hong Kong people working in the mainland, retiring in the mainland. According to the associations of Hong Kong people in Beijing, Hong Kong, Guangdong and Shanghai, we have 300,000 Hong Kong people who are regularly residing and working in these places. So the ties between Hong Kong and these places are getting closer. And many a time, it is things are driven by the community, like the marriage, cross-boundary marriages. One-third of the registered marriages are cross-boundary marriages. The SAR government has never done anything in this regard. So when we look at the issues, we have to look at the bigger picture. I don't think we should do anything or say anything that will impinge on the harmonious relationship between Hong Kong and the mainland. Mr. Pun Siu-ping, President, thank you. Mr. Chief Executive, over the years, every fortnight we have one worker who died in an industrial accident. In the policy address, you talked about infrastructural development and importation of labor. You never talked about the high fatalities in the industrial sector. I am disappointed with you in that. Now, before launching the infrastructural projects, will you be reviewing all the relevant legislation regarding industrial undertakings to ensure the safety of the workers? Chief Executive, President, the Labor Department frequently conducts regular inspection at construction sites. From the news, you get to see that we do take enforcement action to combat the unsafe operations, like lifting, electrical, marine construction, all these hazardous trades. We do pay particular attention. Once irregularities are identified, we take enforcement action without any prior warning. And this is a stringent measure. We do have to take precautionary measures. Prevention is always better than cure. So we do have an award scheme for the construction industry, which mounted publicity. Other than that, we would also like to manage the construction well. We have to deal with the matching of workers with the works. Now, if the schedule is tight, if they are rushing through their work, it is likely that accidents might happen. So when we launch these public works, we have to make sure that they are launched in an orderly manner. Sometimes we may encounter judicial review, or sometimes we may encounter obstacles when we seek funding, and that would result in the projects not being launched orderly. Mr. Pun Siu-ping, Mr. Chief Executive, in your manifesto, you talked about setting up a committee to look into the protection of workers. Now, today it is March, end of March 2015. Now, you talked about this task force on the industrial accidents. How are you going to set this up, Chief Executive? The government will get on with this. Once it is ready, we will get it up and running. Dr. Kwok-pan, President. Siu-ping, you're so thick-skinned, you're lying so much, and you are practicing sophistry really in a masterful manner. And since you've become chief executive, what we see is that you have been practicing nepotism. You curry favor with Beijing, and you are dividing Hong Kong, and you are using this perceived separatism to divide Hong Kong and the mainland. I think this is really something that you're doing for your own personal advantage. The grassroots people are suffering from problems of the parallel trading, and people are having trouble with their school places, and they have problem with the housing. Constitutional reform is really moving no further ahead. Hong Kong is deeply divided. You've been in office for 2 years. During the MPCSC, CPPCC meeting period, there were rumors that they want Hong Kong to vote for the proposal in order that you will not be elected in office for a second time. The Hong Kong people have been suffering all these years. I mean, if it is likely that we may have another 7 years of you in office. The people are arranging for the kids to be educated overseas, or some of them are planning emigration out of Hong Kong. People are so disappointed and so dismayed. Are you going to do any soul searching at this critical juncture? How are you going to lead Hong Kong? Is Hong Kong going to be standing still? Is Hong Kong going to be deeply divided for the sake of your own political career? Are you going to do the decent thing and stop the social rift and do something for Hong Kong? Like, for instance, get on with constitutional reform and allow Hong Kong genuine universal suffrage so that we can cast our vote and elect the chief executive in a proper way and let you step down. Chief Executive, well, if members listen to Dr. Kwokaki, he's self-contradictory, and he said it's likely that I might be in office for another 7 years, and he's also talking about me stepping down. I mean, I'll try to address this question anyway. I am trying to achieve the same purpose as Dr. Kwok. I'd like to have universal suffrage. I'd like to see democracy in Hong Kong. To achieve this, under the basic law, if we have to change the election committee with 1,200 members, we need to have two-thirds majority support and chief executive endorsement and the consent of the NPCSC. I hope that we can have universal suffrage in 2017. The NPCSC's August 31st decision is sufficiently clear. If we want universal suffrage, we have to abide by the framework of the NPCSC decisions on August 31st. What is before Dr. Kwok is very plain. Is Dr. Kwok prepared to vote for the proposal to let Hong Kong people have universal suffrage? If you do not cast a vote, the 5 million people who otherwise would be able to cast a vote will be denied the votes. So the question doesn't lie with me. I've stated my position. The ball is your own court, Dr. Kwok. Now, Dr. Kwok seems to be very gloomy about the situation. The FS delivered his budget not so long ago, and the financial situation is not all that bad, although we cannot take the situation lightly. We do have the condition to offer tax rebate, and we can do more to benefit the grassroots people. As long as members do not engage in filibustering, the extra CSSA payments will be dispersed to the needy families quick, as long as you don't filibuster. In this financial year, the salaries tax is 8 or 9% higher than anticipated. If people do not have any pay rise, it's unlikely that we have any rise in salaries tax. For a long time, the jobless rate is hovering about 2-3%. The government has a robust financial situation with full employment. Inflation is under control. Now, all these are the economic side of the equation. Law and order, it is very good, although Dr. Kwok has his own view about the police. The crime rate is the lowest for 17 years. So we have to be pragmatic. We have to be objective. Just because of your own political or party stance doesn't mean that you have to say what you said. Hong Kong people are discerning themselves. On the question of universal suffrage, those who are prepared to accept universal suffrage in accordance with NPCSC's decision, our number of those who do not accept. If Dr. Kwok and your party respect public opinions, please cast your vote in favor of the proposal in accordance with NPCSC's decision on August 31st. Dr. Kwok, I must clarify that I'm not on the same wavelength as you. Your proposal is a fake universal suffrage. We cannot stomach that. Do you do any soul searching at all? Over the past 2 years, the damage you have done to Hong Kong, the rift you have caused to Hong Kong, you never address this question. Are you going to deepen the rift or widen the rift in Hong Kong, so much so that Hong Kong will reach a point of no return? Chief Executive, as Chief Executive in Hong Kong, I have the obligation to run Hong Kong in accordance with the law, and I have the obligation to endorse what is right and criticize what is wrong. Mr. Felix Chung, in his opening remarks, the Chief Executive talked about the fact that Hong Kong and the mainland authorities would like to see the CE election proposal endorsed. It seems to me that the pandemic and the government are pulling in different directions.
I cannot feel the possibility of the constitutional package being passed in this chamber. Can we have some moderate voices such that we can discuss the situation? Does the CE agree that within a short period of time he should set up a dialogue platform for the issue? Mr. Chief Executive, the SARG is prepared to listen to any views about universal suffrage for the CE election, including dissenting views. Yet, all views have to comply with the basic law and the NPCSC decision on August the 31st. Otherwise, we don't have any foundation for the discussion. Any views that do not comply with the basic law and the NPCSC decision will not be taken up by the NPCSC. Is something not solid? Quite some time ago, it's already said that civic nomination is not in line with the NPCSC decision in terms of universal suffrage for this year election. Now, this is a crucial point. If somebody still insists that the nomination right is not something confined to the nominating committee, then what will be the real nature or effect of this platform for dialogue? Mr. Chung Kwok-pan, many dedicated and committed people, including moderate members of the pro-establishment camp and the pan-democrats, the trio on constitutional reform, even before discussing, rejected their views. So there's no genuine opportunity for us to sit down and have a discussion. So I hope that the trio will shortly launch a platform to hear these moderate voices. Of course, under the basic law and the NPCSC decision, we'll be holding this discussion. Chief Executive, it doesn't depend on whether or not the voices are moderate or radical. It depends on whether these views are based on the basic law and the NPCSC decision. We should not go back to 30 years ago, that is 1985, when the Basic Law Consultative Committee was set up. 25 years ago, the framework had been passed. The Basic Law was passed, and all along it has been the case. Nomination is something for the nominating committee, and now people still suggest civic nomination. It's not a matter of conservative views, moderate views, or radical views. It's stipulated in the basic law that we can have universal suffrage, we should change the electoral methods, we need a two-third majority support in this chamber, and my consent. The CPG has its own stance. If you wanted to start afresh, how can we implement your suggestions? So there's nothing to do with moderate voices. We know there are committed and dedicated persons in society, but no matter how moderate their views are, they cannot present proposals that are against the basic law and the NPCSC decision and turn them into legitimate proposals. Well, let me clarify. I said under the framework of the basic law and the NPCSC decision, but the CE was referring to something beyond that framework. Well, thank you, Mr. Chung, for your clarification. I understand what you meant. The trio is very busy with their responsibilities. Still, they spend time to exchange views with all sectors of the community. In society, views were raised, be it through this chamber or through the media. The trio are is very clear about those views. Mr. To, thank you, President. Just now the CA said that all elections conducted in accordance with the local laws are genuine universal suffrage. Well, very clear. He is saying that power is supreme. So long as he has the power, he can oppress people. Well, even though you got 689 votes, you shouldn't oppress our people. Well, the CA is passing the blame to the NPCSA decision in this sifting mechanism. He has not reflected on himself. Ever since he assumed office, rent and property prices have been soaring. He said that the environmentalists were blocking him. But what about universal retirement protection, standard working hours, light pollution, and equal rights for the homosexuals, legislation on the subject, etc., etc.? You're always passing the buck, the blame to others. CE, I hope that you can say here to Hong Kong people that before you finish your term of office in 2017, the elderly persons will get universal retirement protection. You are over half into your tenure of office. Are you confident? Will you honestly tell us that you will implement this? That is, our elderly persons will benefit before 2017. Chief Executive, I also very much want to do what Ms. Sit-ho said. Well, I'm determined to get that done before 2017. But the premise is that all related issues, that is in relation to universal retirement protection, the LegCo will lend us support. On this, I'm determined, but I must objectively assess the situation. And let me briefly respond to the preamble, so to speak, of Ms. Sito's remarks. Constitutional reform is a major issue. Before Ms. Sito asked her questions, she made some remarks which might present a wrong impression to the public. In the UK, they have universal suffrage. I think Ms. Sito won't say that the universal suffrage in the UK is fake universal suffrage. However, the method of returning the Prime Minister in the UK and also the method of returning the US President are different. In UK, they don't have civic nomination. The UK Prime Minister was not returned by a one-person, one-vote system. Their political parties elected their party chairman, and then during the election, the political party that got the highest number of votes would have their party chairman the prime minister. So they don't actually need to fetch their electors. I don't think Ms. Sito will say that that's fake universal suffrage. In the UK, they adhere to their convention to implement their democracy and electoral methods. Same with France, Germany. Ms. Sito won't say that those are not genuine universal suffrage. In Hong Kong, if we do not observe the basic law in the NPCSA decision, we'll be building a castle in the air. In my manifesto, I made some promises. In the past 2-odd years, those promises were realized one by one. Ms. Sit-ho might have noted that each year on the 1st of July, that is the anniversary of my assumption of office, I present a list on my webpage on what I have done. If Ms. Sito is saying that we should complete all that we've promised within 2.5 years, then she might have not fully understand the complicatedness of the issue. I, of course, want to implement everything in the manifesto one by one, but then the civil service and the electrical may not be able to cope because we need funding from the electrical on a number of areas before we can implement our manifesto. So what can be implemented has already been implemented. The remaining items will be implemented as soon as possible in the remainder of my term. Ms. Sito, well, the CE is still passing the blame to others. He cannot give us a guarantee on universal retirement protection. He passed the blame to the Lechko and those who support universal retirement protection. We've been discussing this for a long, long time. And then he mentioned the complicated situation in the civil service. But all these scenarios existed long before the CE assumed office. I'd like to ask the CE, his knowledge about the UK system is very shallow. The parliamentarians in the UK are returned by one person, one vote system. If the CE has general knowledge about politics, I hope he can accept the challenge from the pan-democrats such that we can have an open and fair debate, such that members of the public will see that the truth will be revealed as we reason. Mr. Donald Zhang did that. Why is the presidency so afraid of this? Is he afraid of public opinion and proper reasoning and truth? Mr. Chief Executive, well, Ms. Sidho's allergy was an analogy is not correct. We cannot compare Hong Kong's CE with the Prime Minister of the UK, because the Prime Minister of the UK is not returned by one person, one vote. Well, just now the CE said that the UK Prime Minister was not returned by one person, one vote. Well, it's now the turn of the CE to speak. The UK Prime Minister is not returned by direct election. I hope Ms. Sito can agree to that point. That's why some people say that the UK Prime Minister is not returned by universal suffrage. Let me go back to my previous argument. Different jurisdictions have different methods for returning their leaders. Different jurisdictions have different systems in accordance with their laws, convention, and electoral methods. They return their leaders. And here, we need to adhere to the basic law and the NPCSC. There's a premise to my remarks. The pan-democrats and the Sito insist that the NPCSC will withdraw its August 31 decision, but the NPCSC has already said that it wouldn't do so. So where is the foundation of this discussion? Well, Mr. Mei-fun, sports can bring us good health. It can also forge social solidarity, and sports also contribute to the economy of Hong Kong. I moved a motion on our sports policy last year. But last year, the CE told the media that sports don't have economic value. The sports sector does not understand that remark and cannot agree with him. Our neighboring jurisdictions have been actively lifting their soft strengths, so to speak. In October last year, the State Council promulgated the policy on sports. Sports will become a state strategy. The GDP will exceed 50,000 yuan, renminbi. And every person should get 2 square meters of sports ground. And 500 million people should be trained in sports. And just recently, a whole series of new initiatives were launched. In Hong Kong, we've been proposing the Kai Tak Sports Complex for many, many years. But apart from that, we don't have clear indicators, and our sports policy has not been updated and reviewed for over 10 years. Nothing about the sports industry. So how will the CE enhance sports development in Hong Kong and for the sports industry, so to speak? Does the CE have any measure to expedite the development of sports?
Chief Executive, the SA government attaches importance to sports development. Mr. Mei-fun-kwok probably still remembers that shortly after we took office, we faced a pretty difficult decision. Our decision shows that we attach importance to sports, and that is the siting of the multipurpose sports complex at Kai Tak. It was originally sited at Kai Tak, but in terms of land value, in terms of economic value, this plot of land fetches pretty high value. If it is used for housing, it would relieve a lot of the pressure. The housing figure is very large in our priority. Eventually, having listened to a wide variety of views, not least the sports community, we decided to use this plot of land for the MPSC. It goes to show that we take sports development pretty seriously. Now, the piece of land is of high value, and the cost of the MPSC is going to be more than $20 billion. This is a massive investment. We also have a whole string of other measures. We have the sports subsidy scheme by the LCSD. We work with the national associations. We have the redevelopment of the sports institute. We also have the pilot scheme in the sports community. All these show that we attach importance to sports in all different aspects. Mr. Mei-fun-kwok, well, the Chief Executive failed to answer my question. Now, developing sports as an industry, I think the government has done a great deal, and we do pin very high hope on the MPSC. Now, how are we going to develop or drive our economy by promoting sports? I don't think the government has considered this. Is the government aware of its potential? In the mainland of China, they have this $5 trillion worth of promotion, and this will be about 3% of the GDP. In Hong Kong, how are we going to take full advantage of sports activities to develop the full potential of sports? Chief Executive, during the election period, I did talk with the sports community about different issues. To develop sports as an industry, it has to do with industrialization. We have to popularize sports. We have to organize mega events of sports. And we have to promote elite sports. Now, in Hong Kong, we cannot compare with the mainland of China. But in terms of our ability, in terms of needs, the Hong Kong SL government has done quite a lot in terms of sports development and developing the potential. Mr. Chen, what the Chief Executive talked about filibustering more than 10 times. He said that the government is caught in disarray, and the Chief Executive has been in office for 3 years. Now, over these past 3 years, he waived tax and rent. This is to the tune of $60 billion. Now, we asked the government to refund people to the tune of $10,000, but the government refused to do so. The Macau government has offered $9,000 recently. The Chief Executive is very much a Mr. Scrooge. Now, he's not completely a Mr. Scrooge. Now, with regard to The third runway is costing us $140 billion, and each one of us will have to shoulder quite a lot of money, and you're wasting resources on this third runway, and everybody in Hong Kong has to shoulder $20,000. And it doesn't make economic sense. It doesn't make environmental sense. Dong Chong is going to be very, very toxic. And in March, at the EXCO meeting, there is a directive that the Executive Council directed the Airport Authority. What authority do you have to give the directive to? The Airport Authority, has a financial agreement been reached? Chief Executive. Well, we have announced the decision taken by the Executive Council on major issues. The Chief Executive in Council can take the decision. Mr. Chen, well, maybe you're not familiar with the legislation. Is it under the Airport Authority Ordinance? Section 2A, that the government can give directives to the Airport Authority. Is it on the basis of the Airport Authority Ordinance, Section 20, that you gave the directive? I think it was on March the 17th, and the EXCO gave the directive. Is it on the basis of this piece of legislation? Second, has there been any financial arrangement reached between the government and the AA, Chief Executive? Well, the Secretary and the Chief Executive Officer of the AA have already addressed the questions. I don't think Mr. Chen should be unduly worried. We're acting in accordance with the law. Mr. Chen, while you were chairing and presiding over the Executive Council, on what basis, on what law, did the EXCO take the decision? You're not answering the question. This financial arrangement, Mr. President, is costing us $140 billion. And you're not addressing the question about the law, and you're not addressing the question about the financial arrangement. Don't you feel surprised by it, Mr. President? Mr. Albert Chan. Mr. Long Kwok Hong, please be seated. I'll address your issue about point of order. Mr. Albert Chan, I'd like to remind members that we have to put questions in accordance with the established procedure. You have, you will be allowed to put a question and a short follow-up. Mr. Chan, this is not a forum for debate. If you do have other views, you should address them on different occasions. Mr. Albert Chan, I think you have put your questions, and the Chief Executive has already addressed your question. Mr. Albert Chan, I've already said that if members are not holding different views to the Chief Executives, we should engage in a debate on different occasions. Mr. Long Kwok Hong, point of order. Well, this is a Q&A session, Mr. President. Mr. Albert Chan put a question to the Chief Executive. Now, he's basically saying that he's taking the decision, and he took the decision and asked us to ask the Secretary. Now, he's refraining from addressing the question. I mean, if I'm asking a question about Leung Chai Yan, I would ask him, Mr. Leung, I think you were busy articulating your views. You probably didn't listen to the Chief Executive sufficiently intently. Please do not breach the rules of procedures. Otherwise, I'll have to order you out of the chamber. Please be seated. Ms. Priscilla Leung, Chief Executive, I've received a phone call from a kid and some people in overseas some countries would like to send the kids to Hong Kong for education. Some Hong Kong people overseas, I mean. My hair stylist is asking me whether I should send my kid to the local universities. And if they're sending them to universities where there are professors urging Occupy Central, then they would be very worried. And some of them would like to emigrate and opt out of the local education system. I think the secondary education in Hong Kong is not all that bad, in particular in relation to the major subjects. Recently, we have compulsory subject, the liberal studies. A lot of the teachers are working very hard, and this is indeed a gaping hole where there is no control whatsoever. Mr. Benny Tai said that he's been to about 100 schools, and he was invited to talk about Occupy Central, all the philosophy of Occupy Central, and as long as they surrender themselves after breaking the law, they will be okay. I think we have to be concerned about the situation. My question is coming up. Now, for these 12, 13-year-olds, they don't have sufficient knowledge to make distinction. Shouldn't we reveal the liberal studies as a subject, the way it is taught and the way it is examined? Or shouldn't we have proper teaching materials? Chief Executive. Well, when teachers are teaching in the classroom, whether liberal studies and so on, they don't have to advocate certain biased views at liberal studies lessons. They can do so in any lessons. I know that many parents and the members of the public are saying that some teachers are advocating their political stance at liberal studies lessons. But I don't think just because of these teachers, we have to obliterate the value of liberal studies as a subject. Dr. Priscilla Leung, Mr. Chief Executive. Well, things are not perfect, but in Hong Kong, we do enjoy a lot of advantages, and many people are coming to Hong Kong for education. Many people, many young people are feeling desperate, and they look at Hong Kong as really doom and gloom. They blame the parents, they blame the whole system. And I hope that, Mr. Chief Executive, please do not evade my question. Liberal studies as a subject is good in the first place. We are not really critical of anything. We just hope that the young people would be able to distinguish rights from wrongs, and they will give full play to their potential and take Hong Kong down the road of healthy development. So will you be inviting true experts on law and to put together teaching materials so that teachers can teach the subject in a proper manner? Chief Executive. I'm sure that the teaching profession does have the capacity. As to whether the government has to take the lead is something that will be should be discussed. I think for young people, we have to allow them to engage in thinking from different angles and different perspectives. It's not for the teachers to indoctrinate them with any political ideologies. There is enough positive energy among the young people. And I think we can talk about all the different issues, the causes, and so on, and let the young people decide and judge for themselves. Dr. Elizabeth Kwok. President, thank you. Mr. Chief Executive, we have a quarter of a million people engaging in tourism or tourism-related trades, and taken together, the number can be 700,000. I'm very concerned about them. Some mainland friends of mine told me that there are some anti-parallel trading protesters insulting the mainland visitors, and they feel very offended, and they tear up their multi-entry permit and refuse to come to Hong Kong. And I was told that we should have mentioned that we are Hong Kong people when we are setting foot in the mainland, because we are liable to be insulted. Now, this is saying a lot about the relationship between the two places, and the law and order, the relationship are undermined by these protesters. And Mr. Gary Fan is referring to all these protesters. Now, after the Occupy movement, some said that the police are making arrests and the judges are setting people free, and they are condoning these militant and radical acts.
I'd like to ask the CA how he will reestablish Hong Kong into a civilized society that treats visitors with hospitality, and how will you mend the relationship between the legislature and the executive, chief executive, when there are breaches of our laws, irrespective of the motive behind that. The police will be impartial in enforcing the law, and in accordance with the prosecution policy and the laws of Hong Kong, will do an enforcement work well. Our judiciary is totally independent, so I won't comment on it. Hong Kong's tourism is very, very important. It contributes to 4.7% of our GDP. Just now I said that its GDP is contribution to our GDP. When compared with laws, accountancy, architecture, medical and health services, etc., they share the same contribution of GDP. For the employees, including grassroots workers, many of them are working in the tourism industry. Therefore, we cannot, because of parallel trading or problematic areas in that regard, or overcrowdedness in certain areas, do something that damage Hong Kong as a capital of hospitality. Once that's damaged, it is very difficult to reestablish our status in that regard. And where there are conflicts, including physical conflicts between mainlanders and Hong Kong people, that's serious. Our relationship with the mainland is much more than our relationship with other jurisdictions. We are interdependent in terms of economy, people's livelihood, and all other aspects of society. Our relationship with the mainland is beyond comparison with our relationships with other jurisdictions. So we shouldn't casually and randomly write articles, speak or act in such a way as to damage that relationship. I agree with Dr. Elizabeth Kwok. On the mainland, not a few people have strong views about Hong Kong people. I mean, adverse views. So if this is allowed to develop, that's not in the interest of Hong Kong, not in the interest of Hong Kong. So when there are breaches, we have to enforce the law, like the anti-parallel trading activities. We must treat our visitors with hospitality such that we'll remain a capital of tourism and hospitality, and we'll give funding to the tourism board in Northwest NT, in Yuen Long. When conflicts occurred, there were strong criticisms in the media. Originally, some people strongly opposed the parallel traders, but after those incidents, they spoke out through the media. So I hope that we can have more positive comments, such that visitors from all over the world will understand that they're welcome here And for those people who would like to stir up trouble, they know what to do. Dr. Elizabeth, what? Can we just rely on publicity and promotion? The number of mainland visitors is rapidly dropping. Some businesses have dropped by 30 to 50%. So CE, they may not be able to survive. So how can we continue to absorb more high-end visitors to Hong Kong so as to maintain the livelihood of those in the tourism industry? Chief Executive, quasi-public bodies, as well as the other parties concerned, have spared no effort in promoting tourism. Indeed, in society, we don't want people to act in a counterproductive manner. Just now, Dr. Elizabeth Kwok mentioned the later situation. During the Lunar New Year holidays, during those few years, when compared with last year, we saw fewer mainland visitors. At the same time, more mainland visitors went to Macau. What does this indicate? Our society has to reflect on this deeply. If this is really the social trend, I'm really worried about our retail industry, transport industry, catering business, and tourism industry. I'm worried. So we're closely monitoring the situation. I'll take this opportunity to appeal to the public not to use excessively strong language or resort to excessively strong action. Ms. Chen Yuen-han, in the past few days and this morning when I listened to the CE in answering Kwok-wai Kun's question, I somehow feel that the CE is adopting a delaying tactic. Why do I have this feeling? This morning he said that he's listening. Well, the standard working hours issue is a complicated issue. CE, you have to refer to your own manifesto. What you're saying now is very far away from what you said then. Just now you tried to persuade the FTU and Chen Yuen-han to support you to run for the post of CE. You then said that you would follow up on Mr. Donald Zhang's action in following up on standard working hours to involve employers and employees, the academia, etc., to discuss this complicated matter. I reminded you that this is a complicated issue, and you copied what I said into your manifesto. What happens now? You're using contract working hours to replace standard working hours. You're just trying to confuse the public. You're not answering Kwok-wai Kun's question. When employees don't have any bargaining power, they can't sign a fair contract with the employers. We've been studying this for a long, long time. For the FTU, we no longer use the term maximum working hours. Chen Yuen-han, please be quick. He doesn't understand, so I have to make him understand. Given that situation, if you continue to adopt a delaying tactic, well, Matthew Cheung was blurring the concepts. So if you're using this to run for another term, it will be very difficult for you. I would like to ask you, when are you going to foot the bill, so to speak? Standard working hours. How are you going to go about it? What you said now is very different from what you said then. Donald Zhang honored his promise, so you're too far away from him. So, President, please ask him to answer when he'll get this resolved. Chief Executive, Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, on the other side, some members are always disturbing us, and they suddenly yelled, and I was shocked. I was scared. Chief Executive, on the issue of standard working hours, I'm very concerned about it. I read a report, a detailed, specific report to review the issue. Mr. Leung Kwok-hung, please leave the chamber immediately. Mr. Abachan, Mr. Chen Chi-chun, please leave the chamber immediately. The three members who breach the rules of procedure, please leave the chamber immediately. I now invite the Chief Executive to answer Ms. Chen Yuen-han's question. Mr. President, concerning standard working hours, the SAIG and I, were including Mr. Matthew Leung, as mentioned, were working hard on the issue. Indeed, just from the experience of other jurisdictions that had adopted standard working hours, there's a wide variety of implementation methods depending on their economy, their economic structure, cultural differences, etc. So we have to comprehensively review the experience of other jurisdictions such that we know how Hong Kong will be impacted upon when we implement a policy on this. We have to promote labor interests. In this regard, we must not be too hasty in our work. Otherwise, it will be counterproductive. You recall that back then, when we implemented the statutory minimum wage to protect labor interests, both in terms of concepts and contents, the situation was simpler than standard working hours. That's also the experience in overseas jurisdictions. For standard working hours, we had to consider the payment or otherwise for the lunch hour. So we have to take into consideration every detail. This is a complicated matter. By way of the committee, we've been collecting views and we have attained an acceptable progress. So we have to conduct detailed deliberation. Once we've made a decision, we have to make sure that it's acceptable to both the employers and employees, and every employee will be able to benefit. Ms. Chen Yuen-han, I'm extremely dissatisfied and disappointed. He's adopting a delaying tactic. To legislate on standard working hours, the coverage can be reconsidered. He's doing the reverse. Honestly speaking, look at the world. 100 jurisdictions of standard working hours, including our own country. Why is he adopting that attitude? He gives me the impression that he is delaying this. He has not seen the plight of our workers. Well, I asked him when. He must answer my question first before I can ask supplementary questions. Well, as soon as possible, we'll implement standard working hours as soon as possible. We'll do the work as soon as possible. Ms. Emily Lau. Mr. President, the FTU and Ms. Chen Yuen-han have been cheated by CY Leung. Hong Kong has 689. I believe the FTU has to repent in front of Hong Kong people. Today, the CE not just wants to cheat Hong Kong people. Ms. Chen Yuen-han, a point of order. Ms. Emily Lau said that FTU and Chen Yuen-han have been cheated. It's for me to judge whether we're cheated. Well, these are processes. I think her remarks are arbitrary. Members, please respect today's meeting. This meeting is for the CE to answer members' questions. If members want to have a debate, they should do so on another occasion.
Why I raised these questions because what he said, they have to listen back at what he said. I think a lot of people have felt cheated. Some of them are here, some of them are not here. Your question, please. I think the chief executive is trying to deceive the electrical and the international community. He's saying that we have to practice universal suffrage according to the local situation. You have universal suffrage in Iran, in North Korea, and the mainland. I mean, you're telling us that this is true universal suffrage. We have signed the ICCPR, and the mainland of China is also a signatory of the IPPCR. Article 25 referred to universal suffrage. Why is it that the chief executive is spouting such nonsense here in the council? If this is the case, there is no chance for you to fight for a genuine universal suffrage. It's okay for you not to do it, and you're telling us that we have to do it in accordance with the system. Do you think you have to retract your words and offer an apology to the local people and the international community? Chief executive. President, if Ms. Emily Lau truly wants the 5 million Hong Kong people to have a chance to elect the chief executive by universal suffrage, we have to do so in accordance with the basic law and the NPCSC's decisions on August 31st. Ms. Emily Lau. Well, the people of Hong Kong did say that they don't want to have an election of any candidates who are pre-screened. If Regina Ip and C.Y. Leung are the candidates, people will be in tears because this is not genuine universal suffrage. Why can you not tell the people of Hong Kong this is not the real thing? Can you telling people to pocket it? If you want them to pocket it, this is not a genuine thing. Why can't you tell the whole truth in the council? Chief executive. The basic law has been promulgated for 20 odd years. It was April 1990 that it was promulgated. Ms. Emily Lau should realize that the basic law provides for the ultimate objective of achieving universal suffrage. And we need to have an amendment of the basic law electoral method, two-thirds majority support, chief executive consent, and endorsement of the NPCSC. Under the basic law, there is a nominating committee making nomination for the candidates to be elected by universal suffrage. For over 25 years, we never heard from Ms. Emily Lau that this is not genuine universal suffrage. Now, we are very close to what is going to happen, and Ms. Emily Lau is bringing this up. At that time, Ms. Lau didn't say after the April 1997 and never talked about a civic nomination and the retraction of the NPCSC's decision. Now, all these opinion polls are telling us that those who are prepared to accept the NPCSC's decision and on the basis of that to take forward universal suffrage, there are more people accepting this than there are people who do not accept this. So we will try our very best in the months ahead to secure the endorsement of members, including Ms. Emily Lau. Today, Ms. Lau and other members and members of the public should realize that they harbored some thought that if they would, as long as they stand firm, then the central authorities will be retracting the NPCSC's decision on August the 31st, and the five-step process will be reactivated, and the nominating committee can be somehow tinkered with. Now, this is not achievable. The MPCC will not retract the decision August the 31st, and the five-step process will not be reactivated. The fact is playing for members under the basic law, under the MPCC decision, we can get on with the election of the chief executive by universal suffrage. Alternatively, the 2017 C election will still be one which is elected by 1,200 election committee members. Now, between the two, which one is going to be more democratic? I think the answer is plain for everybody in Hong Kong. All right, I think we have to draw this Q&A session to a close. Will members please remain standing while the chief executive leaves the chamber? And I'll adjourn the council.